Hello everyone, welcome to Nursing School Explained. Today we'll cover the basics of fluid and electrolyte balance and how it applies to patient care as well as the administration of IV fluids in patient care. To get started, let's start by reviewing some very basic concepts that I'm sure all of you have learned in pathophysiology, but we'll just go back to review these principles to make sure that we have a basic understanding of why things work in a certain way in the body. So first of all, the principle of diffusion. Remember pathophysiology class or physiology class? It's a concept of where you have a container and then we have a semi-permeable membrane in the middle. Now on one side, we have a higher concentration of particles, and on the other side of the semi-permeable membrane, we have a lower concentration of these particles. By the principle of diffusion, the particles will move from the area of higher concentration to the area of lower concentration. Reason being that the body, as diffusion applies to the human body, the body always strives for homeostasis or balance. So the semi-permeable membrane here always tries to equalize both sides of the fluid compartments. And we'll talk later on how this applies to the patient and intracellular, extracellular fluids. So remember, diffusion, particles move. In osmosis, if you see the beaker down there that I drew, again, on one side, on the left side here, we have a higher concentration of particles. Then we have our semi-permeable membrane, and on the other side, we have a lower concentration of particles. Now, see the difference here, green and blue, and in osmosis, the water moves, not the particles, but the water. Again, the body strives for homeostasis, but in osmosis, the water here moves from the concentration of higher on the right side here to the lower concentration on the left side. Something that I like to remember this by is osmosis, H2O. Okay, so keep that in mind as we move on. So just a brief review, principle of homeostasis, the body always strives to have the same amount of fluids or particles on each side of the semi-permeable membrane. Now let's move on to reviewing the major electrolytes. So keep in mind, there's basically two, but really three fluid compartments in the body. First of all, we have our ICF, intracellular fluid. Major intracellular electrolytes are potassium, magnesium, sulfate, and phosphorus. Intracellular fluid makes up about 65% of our total water in the body. So there's a large percentage in sitting in the cells of these electrolytes and fluids. Then when it comes to the extracellular fluid, it gets divided into the intravascular fluid, and I've drawn a blood vessel right here. And in that intravascular fluid, we have mostly sodium, chloride, bicarbonate, and calcium. Total body fluid in the intravascular space makes up about 7% of our total body fluid. Then in between, we have what's called the interstitial space, and that's about 28% of fluid. So the interstitial space is the space between the intravascular fluid and the intracellular fluid, where fluid kind of tends to shift and kind of sometimes accumulate when there are certain disease processes, and we'll review that at a later point. So keep in mind, extracellular fluid, everything outside the cell, intracellular fluid, everything inside the cell, with the major electrolytes of how we typically find them, and then extracellular fluid, intravascularly, that means in the serum. And think about the only thing that we can measure in a patient is what's going on in their intravascular space by taking a blood sample from one of their veins and sending it to the lab to our analysis. So we really can never analyze a patient's intracellular fluid and electrolyte components because we really don't have access or technology to do that. So really, the only thing we can do is take blood from the patient's vein, analyze the sodium, chloride, and so forth components of that, and then come to conclusions as to what's going on in the intracellular fluid, because we know that things typically shift back and forth, and we also know which major electrolytes are typically in the intravascular versus the intracellular space. Now moving on, another concept that applies here is osmolarity, or also serum osmolarity. Now whenever I say serum, it applies to the intravascular space because that is the serum that's the only thing that we can measure. Now typically serum osmolarity is anywhere from 280 to 295 depending on your textbook or the hospital that you might be doing clinicals at or that you're working at. Now every lab might have different values, but in general this is a pretty good range. So refer to your textbook or your professors to make sure that you have the right range so you don't memorize the wrong range here. Now serum osmolarity, you might have known or heard about it before, is basically the concentration of solutes in the serum, in the patient's intravascular space. Now this is basically the concentration of particles that we have here as it applies to the patient's intravascular space. Now, if the concentration is less than 280, then that means that would be basically over here on this side of the semipermeable membrane. So the patient would have less concentration there. And that's usually also called hemodilution. Let me write this in red so that we can distinguish here. And this is also called fluid volume excess. Now, when the concentration in the serum or the osmolarity gets above 295, that means that everything is much more concentrated, much like we have over here on this left side of the semipermeable membrane. And this is called hemoconcentration. Also called fluid volume deficit. This also, you might have heard about this principle before with urine. So urine specific gravity measures the concentration of solutes in the urine. And the higher the number, the more concentrated the urine is, and the more dehydrated the patient typically is. For urine specific gravity, the same principle applies. The lower the number, that means that there's more water than solutes, much like on the right side of this principle right here, and therefore there's more dilution going on. So there's something going on as to where the patient pertaining to the urine now, the electrolytes and the particles that are being filtered by the kidney are more diluted, and there might be certain reasons for that. So moving on, now how does this apply to our patient? How does the fluid movement apply to the administration of IV fluids?